Glenn Sherwood. I've been the recording engineer for the Longmont Symphony 30 years, but I've played in the orchestra longer than that, on contrabass, and also on cello in the early years. Playing in it gave me a better knowledge in doing this. I had an interest in hi-fi sound and electronics as a kid in the old vacuum tube days. I built a tube tester kit and an audio amplifier made by Merrill. I did some electronics study in school. Later, I built Dynaco kits that were solid state, and I experimented with building speaker systems. Then I began recording song demos in the late 1970s on a four-track open reel recorder using the Shure SM57 microphones. The SM57 is a rugged, dynamic microphone widely used on stage, and it is popular with singers, but the response range is limited and it has no internal power. A web search can give you more information. All microphones should have graphs that show response. This can help you choose the best microphone to use for the result you want. Recording symphony orchestras was a thing I wanted to try as I grew up playing music in the schools. One inspiration was a recording of Copland's Appalachian Spring that won a Grammy Award in 1981. It has remarkable clarity. I had to learn this. You need better microphones for an orchestra, and I have mostly used stereo microphone arrays. I began using one array of two microphones, and the process evolved to mostly using only two of these arrays, comprised of four microphones, over the years. I first learned about stereo microphone methods in reading an article sound engineer Bruce Bartlett wrote in Modern Recording in 1981. Bartlett wrote a book in 1987 that has this same information, and more. I wrote a technical paper on the topic many years later in researching these methods, which expanded my knowledge. These basic stereo microphone arrays can be described as coincident, near coincident, and mid-side methods. The coincident pair is often called an XY array, and stereo audio can often be produced by just using two microphones that have the elements in close proximity and with a 90-degree angle between them. Special holders make this setup easier. One microphone points right and the other points left. The near coincident array has a few variations, but the French National Broadcasting ORTF microphone array is one where there is a 110-degree angle and a 7-inch spacing between elements. It's been said to produce more natural-sounding stereo in listening with headphones, as it emulates human hearing. The 110 degrees is thought to be analogous to the oral cavities, and the 7-inch spacing is thought to be like the spacing between eardrums. Microphones in these array types should be matched, but the mid-side array uses two microphones that are somewhat different. One problem that can arise in these arrays is phase cancellation. If the right and left microphone signals are mixed together, there can be a phase cancellation that occurs related to the wavelength of the distance between microphones. And this is a problem that can arise with using more than one microphone in general. If a note reaches two microphones located at different distances, there can be destructive interference that can cancel or produce a dull, muted sound. The 3-to-1 rule is where microphones placed 1 foot from a sound source should be separated by a distance of 3 feet. In 1987, I was asked to play bass in a PhD recital by Antonio Joy Wilson at CU Boulder. I had just bought a Sony PCM501ES digital processor and some other equipment, and I asked Antonio if I could record it as a test. So I recorded the session at Gruzin Music Hall on June 20th, 1987. At some point, Music Hall at the CU Music School had been named Gruzin after CU alum Dave Gruzin, who graduated in 1956 and is quite famous as a movie music composer. But some called the hall Gruesome in 1987, as the stage had a concrete floor and a fairly low ceiling. Acoustical improvements later made it better, but back then it was fairly live when I recorded the Wilson recital. The program included Stravinsky Rite of Spring and the Barber Adagio for strings. I just used 2 Sony ECM23F back electret condenser microphones in an ORTF array on a tall pole in the center of the orchestra. Most condenser microphones are of the backplate electret type, and they have internal electronics. The ECM23F has a field effect transistor in its internal amplifier, and it requires batteries. But the small diaphragm microphones like this are thought to be of higher precision. They have a very flat and a very wide frequency response for an orchestra. I ran microphone cables through inputs on a cassette deck with matching transformers, and from there into the PCM processor, recording its video output on a VHS video cassette recorder. The results were truly amazing, and Antonio wrote me a letter about the quality. It was that recording that got me the job recording the Longmont Symphony. Here's an excerpt from that Rite of Spring recording. You can hear a lot of bass drum in the Rite of Spring, and this excerpt has several loudness peaks. The percussion in an orchestra is often stage right or in the left stereo channel. If we look at those loudness peaks in an editor like SoundForge XP and run the statistics function on one of the loudest ones, we can see that the maximum is 99.57%. or minus 0.03 dB on the decibel scale. You can't exceed 100% modulation or 0 VU in the computer, and this is almost there. The bass drum is creating these spikes. It is the most powerful instrument in the orchestra. This has been documented in studies such as the one cited in the Master Handbook of Acoustics by F. Alton Everest, where the chart shows a bass drum outputting 25 acoustical watts. This is far above the relative output of most other instruments. The orchestral bass drum is double-headed and rod-tensioned, and it can be 40 inches in diameter. A bass drum can be over 4 times as loud as a trombone, which is shown as having an output level of only 6 in this ratings chart. Loudness peaks are a reason to have a wide dynamic range in a system. Specifications on the Sony ECM23F microphones show they have more than 110 dB dynamic range and can handle 134 dB SPL. SPL is the sound pressure level. Some sources claim the threshold of pain in human hearing is 125 to 130 dB SPL, or where sound can be painful. The softest sound is said to be 0 dB. The loudness of a jet engine might be 150 dB. The loudness of a rifle might be 170 dB. I began to experiment with the MS or mid-side microphone arrays in 1995. It is thought to have better mono compatibility. There are several setups for this. The M microphone is a cardioid, and the S microphone is a figure 8 type. The stereo audio is produced by combining the positive and negative sides of the S microphone with the M microphone. This can be done by using a microphone preamp that has inverting outputs on the S channel and a special decoding matrix, or by using 3 channels on a mixer. The S positive and S negative channels are panned left and right and combined with the M channel to produce conventional stereo. The 4-track method I've been using has an MS array up high at the front of the orchestra and an ORTF array overhead at a height of about 13 feet. The distance between these arrays front to back is about 20 feet. 2 arrays are used for balance and to avert phase cancellation. If that should occur with the ORTF array, the M microphone on the MS array can fill that void. The MS array I'm using consists of an AT4031 for the cardioid mid microphone and a AT4050-CM5 switchable pattern type for the side microphone. Both are Audio-Technica. The ORTF microphone array consists of a pair of ATM31A Artist Series that have back electret condenser capsules, also from Audio-Technica. These microphones require 48-volt phantom power, which is supplied through the microphone cables. The microphone cables use a system called balanced audio and features a noise-canceling design, which allows long cable runs. All microphones have a polar pattern shown as a graph to describe the directional response. The ones I am using all have a cardioid, or a unidirectional response pattern, that is heart-shaped, rather than being omnidirectional or having a spherical response. The cardioid type tends to reject sound from the rear. The polar graph also shows the microphone's frequency response at various angles, and a linear graph shows the frequency response overall. The response should be fairly flat down to 30 Hz or lower for an orchestra, as a low B note sometimes used is 30 Hz. These microphones need a preamp to bring the signal up to line level. The preamp for the MS array was one I built from a kit from PAIA Electronics called a 9215 that has inverting outputs. They also made a MS decoder kit that I also built. It can be used to decode the MS tracks recorded on tape outside of the rack. We record a discrete 4-track backup VHS tape that can be used to do a remix if it is needed. It's a hybrid tape that has MS tracks on video and digital, and the ORTF tracks on VHS hi-fi. The 2 out from the mixer in the rack was being recorded on a DAT recorder for many years, but now it is recorded on a Tascam DR60D that saves files to memory cards in the Redbook WAV format that can be burned to CDs directly. The goal is to produce natural-sounding stereo audio that someone in the audience might hear at a concert. One aspect of this is accurate localization. Instruments in the orchestra should sound in the same position as where they were located on the stage. The percussion and violins should be in the left channel, and the basses and cellos should be on the right, with instruments in the center sounding centered, if this is how the stage layout was done. Two arrays help achieve a better overall balance, with each instrumental group having about the same ambiance. If only one array is used at the front of the group, the instruments that are further away can sound more distant and reverberant. The front array is helpful in capturing the front stands of string players and any soloists that are located by the conductor, and the center array can help improve presence on the woodwinds and give a better character of sound on those soloists that is more consistent overall. An alternative setup has been used in situations where we did not want microphone poles on the stage, such as recording a large choral concert. In that situation, I've used a space pair with a microphone far left in the left channel and a microphone far right in the right channel, and the midside stereo array in the center, and then those channels combined in a mixer. I would rather not do any signal processing on these recordings, but depending on the acoustical environment, it might be desirable to add some reverberation to the files in the computer. But it should be done sparingly, and it can depend on the musical content of the music being recorded. We come to know many people in a group like this over many years. There is a fellowship to it, and when a group is playing great music, there can be a synergy that's greater than what we are alone. Here are some excerpts recorded with the four-track process.
Thank you.